स्टार्ट
टाइम हो रहा है ना यार, टाइम हो गया। चलो
लेट अस स्टार्ट।
हिमाचल में प्रॉब्लम है, आज लाइट की दिक्कत है।
Hello everyone, thanks for joining us today for another Deck Invaders webinar series event. Today we are going to have a talk on birds of Himachal Pradesh and some species specific conservation efforts which have been undertaken under it. With us today, our speaker is Divisional Forest Officer at the headquarters, Mr. D.S. Dadwal sir. He is a birder, he's a conservationist, educator, author, and also a government official. And his contribution towards the protection of wetland and its ecosystem has several laurels to him. He photographed and documented about 669 species of birds just in the state of Himachal Pradesh. As you can see, JVD sir is showing the book. It's divided into two books, Volume 1 and Volume 2, Non-Passerines and Passerines. So it's a wonderful book. So these were documented in two volumes, and his contribution also in Vulture Institute Conservation Program for White Trump Vultures are unparalleled, as the vulture population is in Himachal Pradesh has bounced back strongly with the nest number going up to 400 plus from 400 plus in 2019-2020 from 26 in 2004-2005, which is a massive increase in number. Also, he worked extensively in Himachal Pradesh to address the man-animal interface and rescuing animals as well. He is also an excellent storyteller and is involved in providing education and awareness sessions on the identification of flora and fauna. Also, he is an expert in handling snakes and other wild animals as well, which are organized by the Forest Department, WWF, training institutes, and other wildlife institutes which come for him for the help. So thank you, Dadwal sir, for accepting our invitation and giving us the opportunity of learning about Himachal Pradesh and knowing the different flora, fauna of that location. Thank you so much. And now I would be leaving the floor to you, sir. You can start your presentation.
May I, a small request, Srikant, can you please tell him?
I've muted everyone. Dadwal, sir, I think you have to unmute yourself once, please.
Yes.
And thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And the floor is for you.
Thank you, Srikant ji and JVD sir. I extend my thanks to Deccan Birders that you gave me this opportunity to talk about birds of Himachal Pradesh. So, good evening friends. I am D.S. Dadwal. I am talking about the birds of Himachal Pradesh. I will also talk a little bit on Pong Lake, and then as a bird budding friends or nature lover or wildlifers, what we can do. A little contribution will make a big difference at the last. And this is a little bit about the birds of Himachal Pradesh. So, sorry, there's some issue with the... My slide is hanged, it's not moving further.
No, probably the arrows.
Yes. Just 1 minute.
Yeah, sure.
Just 1 minute. It's not going. Yes. So little bit about Himachal Pradesh. If you see the vertical extent of Himachal Pradesh, subfoothill is about 350 meters from mean sea level, and it goes up to 7,000 meters. So I will say the height of Himachal Pradesh is 6.5 kilometers. So it's very tall state, but not wide enough. So tall state means fit, slim, active, vibrant with a lot of things. So that altitudinal variation of 6.5 kilometers is providing, you know, different set of climatic conditions, and those conditions are ensuring different set of habitats for different genera across, for birds. And those different habitat strata, they are ensuring enough food and place to roost and breed and grow. So Dharamshala is the rainiest place in Himachal Pradesh, and Lahaul Spiti is the driest. There's no hardly any rainfall in Lahaul Spiti. So little bit about position of Himachal Pradesh in Western Himalayas. If you see on the left at the top, there's this Sachutwa Wildlife Sanctuary, and it is touching Jammu and Kashmir on the eastern part of Himachal Pradesh. So there are different set of climatic conditions, and the make of Himalayas is such that birds across Himalayas, they are coming and visiting to these areas. If you see on the right side, there is a Kibber Wildlife Sanctuary. And this Kibber Wildlife Sanctuary is touching Leh on the other side, Jaskar Range, Great Himalayas, and then Trans-Himalayas. So that different set of conditions is attracting other set of birds in these areas. If you see lower bottom, there is a Pong Lake, and it is in foothills. It has its own unique ecological values that I will talk in subsequent slides. And the right extreme, this is Simbalwada National Park. The new name is Sherjang Bahadur National Park now. Many species, their distribution is up to Uttarakhand. But species, they are spilling over to this area and adding to the avifauna values of Himachal Pradesh. Now, about protected areas network, we have 15% of our geographical area under these protected areas. There's a Great Himalayan National Park that is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And if someone is interested to see this rare beauty, the Western Tragopan, that is Jujurana. Jujurana means king of birds. So Great Himalayan National Park is the best location where you can visit and see this bird. This is a Pong Lake. We have 3 international Ramsar sites. So Pong is quite famous for wintering birds. So we have 5 national parks and 26 wildlife sanctuaries. In Himachal, we are also doing this in-situ conservation programs, in-situ as well as ex-situ conservation programs. If you talk about Saran pheasantry, there is a Western Tragopan in-situ conservation program. We also have a small breeding center where Western Tragopan is being bred artificially. And that is the only, you know, breeding point on this planet where Western Tragopan is being bred, and in future it will be released back in the wild conditions. Similarly, we have chief pheasant conservation programs. The soft release of this species is already done, and people are on the job to release back in the wild conditions. The cheared pheasant, if someone is interested to see this rare bird, these are the grasslands in district Shimla and Kangra and other areas. But Shimla and district Kinnaur is the best places to see this bird. Himachal Pradesh is also going to play a big role as far as distribution and migration, understanding of bird species is concerned, because we have permanent ringing station at Pong Lake that I will talk later on. I'll come to vulture in situ conservation programs. You know, much is talked about vulture conservation. Population has drastically gone down. As far as studies, if we talk about Gyps bengalensis, that is white-rumped vulture, its population has crashed by 99.9%, and there's 100% mortality in wild conditions. These are the studies. But accidentally, when I started in the year 2004-05 in district Kangra in summer season, I could count 26 nests of these white-rumped vultures on cheel trees, that is Pinus roxburghii. Then till 2009, I did nesting survey with the help of my friends. And immediately after 2009, Forest Department senior officers, they were convinced that we have to do it systematic conservation program. You see, last year, the nest of this single species in single district Kangra has gone up to more than 400 nests. So we did small interventions, like since these birds are breeding on Pinus roxburghii and they are prone to fire during summer. So we put people so that these nests can be protected from fire. we stopped resin tapping with the help of Forest Corporation. There was a lot of resentment because this livelihood issue, the money to government is concerned. But anyhow, we could stop resin tapping in these areas. We could also stop felling of dead and dry trees from these areas because, you know, these dry trees are used for surveillance by these vultures. They are playing a big role for the survival of these species. Similarly, we are also doing systematic annual bird estimation in Pong Lake. Right from October till March, this fortnightly survey we are doing. And there's an annual bird estimation every year in the last 3 days of Jan month that we are doing since 2003-04. And coming to bird diversity, 669 species so far have been photographed, recorded in Himachal Pradesh. And you see the diversity, that is more than 50% of what we have in the entire Indian subcontinent. We have 49 summer species as summer migrant, 112 species as winter migrant. A good number of passes migrants also, 49 species are recorded. If we talk native species in Western Himalayas, there are 11 species. One species, that is Himalayan quail, is supposed to be extinct. So 10 species are there in Western Himalayas. And luckily, we all 10 species are there in Himachal Pradesh. So that is the importance. We also have 5 species critically endangered, and many of them are these vulture species. You can see photograph white-rumped vulture flying. We have 7 endangered species. You can see black-bellied tern is a common resident bird in Pong Lake. Vulnerable species 13, you can see western tragopan is a beautiful bird. It's mesmerizing. Anybody can stop to see this bird. We also have uncommon visitors in Himachal. I will talk later on why they are coming to Himachal. Hooper's wren, it was photographed in 2012. I was lucky to photograph this species in Pong Lake. You can see this pair, big bird. Then we could photograph European golden plover, also Caspian plover. To my knowledge, Eurasian skylark, the largest congregation of this species is in Pong Lake. And it is also breeding in summer in Pong Lake. And that is, to my knowledge, is some of it's a very rare record that Eurasian skylark is breeding. And the first record of this red-necked grave from India is also from Himachal Pradesh, that is Pong Lake. It was recorded way back in Pong Lake also. Now coming to the regions, basic regions, why we have a lot of avifauna diversity in Himachal Pradesh. So first is, I think I have told you that Himachal is very tall, 6.5 kilometer tall and very wide, not much wider. But we have different layering of Himalayas here, and that those layerings ensure different, you know, habitat stratas where they can survive and thrive. If you see the foothills, all common species, right from common myna to pigeon to babblers, to the top we have Tibetan partridges, you know, and even black-necked crane and all other species of high altitude areas, they are there. We also have the largest avifauna diversity in terms of species and numbers, if we talk Northern India or Western Himalayas. And that is more than 50% of Indian subcontinent. We also have the largest congregation of bar-headed geese outside the breeding ground. To my knowledge, the population of bar-headed geese are around 130,000 on this planet. And more than 50% of the population is coming to Pong Lake every year. Besides this, we have vagrant species. As per the historical records, these are the vagrant species. I say these are coming regularly to Pong Lake. Every winter, this greater white-winter geese is coming. The maximum number was 76, which were recorded, but around 10, 20, 30, 40 birds there. Every winter, they are coming here. Then lesser white-fronted geese, 4 numbers, the highest number, but every winter, 1 or 2 individuals are coming to Pong Lake. Little gull, someone is really interested to see Little Girl in India, I think Pong Lake, the Deherghad, is the best location. 100% surety that you will see Little Girl in Pong Lake. Although Pong Lake and Himachal is landlocked and fresh water bodies are there, but many coastal species, they are coming to this wetland. This is photographed in Pong Lake. This is also photographed. European, this oriental plover is also photographed in Pong Lake. Besides many regions, I think this is one of, this is at the top that why we have this much of biodiversity in Himachal Pradesh. First is the Central Asian Flyway, this green belt. So birds from these areas, right from Arctic, from the Siberia, and coming to, from Central Asia, they're coming to Himachal. So BART is coming through Sindhu's River and then branching off to Himachal Pradesh, wintering here, all the ducks and geese, and then going back in spring season. And there's another migration pattern, that is this Asian East African Flyway. So birds from this flyway, they are also coming to Himachal Pradesh. All of you are knowing about this Amu falcon story, how it is coming and falling and then crossing India and then Arabian Sea and going up to Africa and going back again. So this is the westernmost distribution in India, I think, because Amu falcon is also photographed and recorded every winter in Himachal. Very few species from this East Asian Australasian flyway, they are also reported from Himachal. So this is one of the main regions that Himachal location is under the migratory routes of it, birds which are coming across the borders. This is another factor which I personally believe that if you see states which are at higher latitude, the wetlands are freezing during winter. Water temperature is going below 4 degrees centigrade. Celsius. So there's hardly any micro activity within the wetlands. No, everything got seized. So birds, they are coming, crossing Himalayas and finding this wonderful wetland near Dholadhar ranges, which is not freezing. It is in foothills, quite big wetland. So there's enough photo period, sunlight is there during winter, and that is kick-starting the micro activities on the shallow banks. Because of that photosynthesis, all aquatic vegetation, you know, those aquatic invertebrates, they are in abundance, and all dabbling ducks and diving ducks, they are getting enough food. And these vast drawdown areas, they are also providing enough space to roost. So this is another reason that this Himachal is getting additional, you know, those habitat qualities that birds are staying during winter. Another reason is like leapfrog migration. If you see these Himalayas at the top, these trans-Himalayas, whenever there's a disturbed habitat patterns, the birds are immediately just jumping down and settling around these areas in Himachal Pradesh. So I've seen many times that birds, whenever there's a rough weather, the birds are coming up and then immediately when their things are clear, they're again coming down. So especially these barred-eared geese and ruddy shelled ducks, they are also breeding in the higher reaches of Himachal Pradesh. Like in Spiti, we have seen this ruddy shelled duck and barred-eared geese with chicks. So they probably they are breeding in the nearby ranges, higher ranges of Himachal. Then very interesting is this foothills, that many raptors, they are entering the foothills, following foothills and going up to this Himachal Pradesh. Like these, they're coming up to Himachal Pradesh and then crossing this Arabian Sea and Africa and going back. So many eagle species, they are coming here. I photographed even white-tailed eagle here in Himachal, Amur falcon also, then steppe eagle, all kind of eagles, they are there. Sacred falcon also. So this is the time when they are coming and adding to the avifauna diversity of Himachal Pradesh. Then there are wonderful mountain passes in Himachal, and you see there's a interesting migration local loop, I will say. You see these passes, the birds in autumn migration, they are coming from Pakistan, entering Sindhu River and then branching off to Himachal Pradesh. And during spring season, there's an interesting migration. They are probably not going to the same route. They are passing through these passes and then they are breeding in the Trans-Himalayas. I'm saying because during summer, spring season, I have heard, my friends have heard that during night, these when the birds are flying through these passes, they are calling like, so a lot of calls you can hear during winter, during nights in the spring, early spring times. But during autumn, when they are coming to this side of the state, there's hardly any call. We never heard any flock or bird is calling and coming back to Himachal Pradesh. Interestingly, also, I will request the senior birding fraternity that it can play also important role to understand the distribution and migration of these birds, ducks, geese, and waders. They are coming through these passages. And if we monitor their population, it's easy these days. If we monitor this population, then we can generate a wonderful data sitting along these passages or something like that, or temporary ringing station. And many species, the distribution ends up to Uttarakhand. And so if you see the distribution of this five-tailed sunbird, it's up to Uttarakhand. Likewise, you will not find these species in mainland Himachal. Five-tailed sunbird, green-tailed sunbird, hooded pita, and this crested tree swift. Their distribution is mainly up to this end of Uttarakhand. But these species, sometimes they are spilling over to this Simbalwada National Parks and adding to the existing biodiversity of or the avifauna diversity of Himachal Pradesh. So there's a different set of climatic condition along with the formation of Himalayas. Those set of conditions are allowing species to further come to Himachal temporarily, and that is an addition to the species diversity and numbers. If we talk about Pir Panjar ranges on the western side of Himachal Pradesh, touching Jammu and Kashmir, there's a Pir Panjal ranges, and on the other side is Jammu and Kashmir. So there's different passes and birds they're of different genera. They are coming and staying during winter. Some of them they are passing through and going to other parts of India. But many of them they are staying in temperate zone, I will say. Like this yellowhammer is there, Bramling is there, chaffinch is there, and brown bullfinch, they are also coming regularly to these areas. So That is another gateway in western edge of Pir Panjal ranges. So Inner Himalayan and Greater Himalayas, I will not say they are adding, but they are allowing two species to stay during winter and summer, because they are providing enough space for them to roost and feed and grow during summer. You see these flock of Grandala, hardly they are coming down there. In Great Himalayas, sometimes they are coming to lower, upper Inner Himalayas. And if you see this image of plant, this is Pyrespecia canth. They are in good number in habitations. They are in open forest. And these species, Bramling and chaffinches, I have seen their flocks, pine buntings, and this yellowhammer. They are roosting on these trees during winter. But unfortunately, you know, we are greedy species on this planet. So we are selling these areas and people are changing the things there. So the change in land use pattern, the things are going to be bad for these species in the near future. So there's a different amalgamation at the top. We have Great Himalayas, Trans-Himalayas, Jaskar Range, and there's an element of Tethiasi, because there are fossils in Spiti areas. And different, these species, Tibetan partridges, otherwise you can see in Leh Ladakh only, black-necked crane that is also coming here, Eurasian magpies, Tibetan larks, Tibetan snowfinch, brown accenture also. These are all photographed in Spiti. You see the wonderful landscape, these Spiti areas. But you know, with the changing land use patterns and our requirements, people have started planting these areas with willow and poplar species. So moment we start planting these areas with tree species, you know, change in sun radiations, change in climatic factors, and that may bring rain in near future. And these are the sandy mountains, and you will know their future if there will be heavy rainfalls. And this is a wonderful habitat for finches and all kind of, you know, larks, bagtails, pipits, they are breeding here. So there's a big threat now with the plantation. So it has unique value. It should be like that. Now coming to second part, I'll talk about a little bit about Pong Lake. So I've spent a lot of time in Pong Lake. It also has one of the largest congregation of many species. 432 species have been photographed here. Winter visitor birds are coming in summer also. Many species of terns, skimmer, and larks, pipits, they are breeding on the ground here. They are passes migrants, coastal species. Although it's a freshwater inland water body, but species from east, south India and west south India, the coastal species, they are coming to Himachal Pradesh, and Pong is a freshwater body. They are staying here before coming to these breeding grounds. So they are spending here some time, and that is the time in March, April and May that you can see these coastline species, saline water species here. They are in breeding plumage. So they are spending some time here. So photographers would like to come to photograph these species in breeding plumage. So we have permanent ringing station here at Pong Lake also. And you see this this common red shank, it was ringed in Point Calimer and it was recovered in Pong Lake. So we have permanent ringing station. We were doing ringing and collaring earlier with Bombay Natural History Society. But recently we did some work with scientists from Games and Wildlife Trust, UK, and scientists from BTO also, and some other agencies, they can also join. Because this permanent ringing station, to my knowledge, along with Point Calimer, they can play a wonderful role in understanding migration and distribution pattern of species, not only within but across Himalayas. Once we have data that species are coming from Europe or Central Asia or Siberia or whatever country, China or Southeast Asia, once the facts are with us, we can convince international communities for conservation and protection. Especially these areas where it is reported that a lot of hunting is going on. So our efforts in India or Himachal Pradesh will not be fruitful if we will not get collaboration with these countries across the borders. So we will get the collaboration and cooperation if we have facts in hand. So I think this Pong Lake is, this permanent ringing station is going to play a big role in the near future. So we did migration studies of water birds also with BNHS. We put 26 transmitters on birds, especially geese and ruddy shelled egg, and to know their distribution and migration within across the Himalayas. So I have put these two, three slides. One is barred geese with this number. We ringed it in March 2011, and it left Pong Lake 13 April 2011. And it went to Kailash Kora in Tibet and reached there on 12th May. And almost 1,000 kilometers this bird covered, and it bred here and then came back again during next winter. Similarly, we have grey leg geese in this number marked at Pong Lake Dam on 18th Feb 2013. It covered up to 100 kilometers, returned back, moved again 250 kilometers at Chamoli, Jammu and Kashmir, and where we got last signal. So birds are going to Tibet, they are going to Jammu and Kashmir sites also, and other recovery we got from Nepal border also. So they are scattered to Tibet and nearby areas of Trans-Himalayas. Similarly, we did this on Brahmani shell duck, ruddy shell duck, so marked on 14th March 2011 and left Pong, and then it went to Takla Makan Coal Desert, and then it bred there and stayed there, and almost it covered more than I think 1500 kilometers, bred there and then returned back again. So these species, whatever we put, is they are breeding in nearby areas only. They are not going further north. So I will come to third part of my presentation. I'll say deliberately green tragedy. If you talk about grasslands in around wetlands or grasslands in temperate zones or higher reaches, Everywhere there is an attempt to put plants, lot of trees. In the monsoon season, and we are talking putting trees, lot of thousands and lakhs of trees. You know, the nature is not uniform, it's not homogeneous. Nature like, you know, indiscipline approach. Nature like entropy in the system. Nature has sandbanks, dry lands, you know, cold lands, hot lands, horse lands, open lands. But we, as a human being, we are trying to make it homogeneous by putting trees everywhere in open areas. You know, these areas around wetlands, they are so good for these reeds. They are so important for these reed warblers, species from Rallidae families, bitterns, rails, crakes. And these grasslands, they are so important for finches and buntings and these wagtails, pipits. All kind of species. So we need not to kill these species. We need not to hunt these species. That just by killing, you are just, you know, spoiling the species. I will say, you plant the tree, you destroy the habitat, you will kill the species, because population will not grow and it will stop growing. And the moment it will stop growing, it will go off. And I will say it's kind of organized crime. We have to understand it, and it's a very sensitive issue. We don't want uniformity. You have seen locust attack on Western India recently. Those tedidal, they have come up to those areas because we have increased the greenery. We have put the trees. We have changed the climatic factors. So it's so something we have to understand it. So I've talked to this tree patient. It's not plantation. Plantation means grasses, shrubs, trees of different strata. This is something like tree patient. We are putting only long, long trees. Another thing is non-forest habitats. Legally and otherwise also, we talk about tree lands, big, big trees. Sandbanks, rocks, mud spliffs, loose stones, they have their own ecological role. Loose stones means you do mining, you pick up the stones, do construction, forget, because they are not doing anything. There's no role. Mud split, they're just open land. You do agriculture, you do plantation here. But you know these species, these waders, they are finding, they are preferring these mud splits, the pratencos and lapwings, all kind of species, they are thriving on these loose stones. So we have to give importance to these habitats. It's not only green patches, non-green patches created by nature. We have to respect that. Everywhere, whenever we are talking, we want clean and green forest. We want a forest which looks like orchard, green patch of grasses with dressed trees, conifers and all kind of with clear bole. We prefer trees with big clear boles, and we are saying this is a healthy forest. No, it's not a healthy forest. We want dead and dried trees. If you go to temperate zone anywhere in Himachal or elsewhere, people are abusing that these trees are dying, and department or other people are not picking up these trees. They should be picked up and thrown somewhere, because they are not required. They are giving you bad look, because these trees have its own role. You know these woodpeckers, you know the raptors, other species are roosting there. They are roosting and they are using these trees for surveillance. And these dead and died trees, they have one of the highest biodiversity in terms of insects and amphibians. So we need these trees also. We need not to fell them. Recently, there's another approach from, I will not name the any organization, but there's an approach that silviculture approach operations are going on. People are felling trees to see the growth of the trees, to put the plants of their own choice. They want clear bole, healthy trees. But nature doesn't want it. So it's a fight between human-centric approach and multi-species approach. Human-centric approach, what is good for us? We want clear bole, a forest which can produce maximum timber, a forest which can produce maximum return to humans. But nature doesn't like it. Nature wants crooked trees. Nature wants shrubs. Nature wants grasses. So these silvicultural operations, they are human-centric, they need to be addressed, they has to be multi-species-centric. Food quality, Yes, we have abundance of food in Himachal and elsewhere. Everywhere there's a food, no problem. But off late in Himachal also, there's a lot of pressure from horticulture and to grow off-seasonal vegetables because everyone wants profit and livelihood. So there's a load of pesticides and insecticides. And after monsoon, it is all washed into water bodies. And you know, those all dabbling ducks and those invertebrates, aquatic invertebrates, what is going to them? The food will be destroyed. This will be nothing for dabbling ducks and diving ducks to feed upon. And then there's a heavy metal concentration also. So food quality is an issue which needs to be addressed now. So next part of my presentation is, like all my friends, you are here listening to me. I request to all of you to spend 1 hour in a year, forget about population dynamics of the species in wild conditions. We don't want to know population of a particular species, how many miners are there, how many jungle babblers are there. We want to know if the species is critically endangered or native or some issue with its growth. That's okay. But in general, what we can do, we need only systematic species richness approach. So what we can do all together, we can fix 1 hour in 1 year. You fix the day yourself, you fix the length right from maybe 6 a.m. to 7 a.m. in the morning. You fix the length, maybe 2 kilometer or a point or a grid. What we can do simply is like 2020, we see 20 species in a particular area grid. Next year, same grid, same time, 15 species. Year-wise, if we record these things, I'm telling you, it's going to create wonders for as far as management intervention is concerned, because we are doing management intervention without knowing the actual requirement of the nature. We have to understand the requirement of the nature. Unless we understand the ecological requirement of that area or unit or grid, we cannot do any intervention. So this we can do. Your next slide, 1 hour, you select any tree in front of your home. You can select a pond, you can select a 2 kilometer, 3 kilometer trail, you can select your kitchen garden, your roosting, feeding, anything you can select. If you spend 1 hour and every year, this is 6 years observation from now onwards, and if this number of species, they are going down, it will give us some indication. It will give some indication, a trend to the management authorities that what is wrong with this. Maybe poaching, somebody poached animals. There may be biotic interference. This earlier, no one was going here, but now we started going there. There may be interventions. People have done something in the name of management. They might have, you know, planted trees or grasses or soil conservation works, which were not actually required. There may be predation of the species. So these hints we will get, and then we can do intervention in that area. So right now what we are doing intervention, and they are saying, no, something has gone wrong. So all of us, we can do with little input besides photography and bird videography, this small observation, and we can do wonderful interventions. Way ahead, species richness approach, photography and videography is okay, but we need to have a species richness approach so we can contribute a lot. We have to map the habitat and their fragmentation of at least uncommon species and native species. And there has to be a landscape approach. People are talking luckily about these things now. The last is multi-species centric approach. Something good for humans is good? No. We have to think about multi-species centric approach now. You know, it's a balance. Like on one hand side, there's a humans, Homo sapiens sapiens. On other hand, there are other species. So other species are going up and humans are, they're putting more and more bait on this planet. So what we are doing, instead of reducing our own bait, we are putting negative interventions on the other side. It's going again up. Like I'm telling you, putting trees everywhere, bringing homogeneity in habitat, is again going to destroy this. So we have to balance it somewhere. And that is possible only we will understand ecology of different species, not only single species. So the last slide, Himachal. Sorry if I'm overrating Himachal, but it's not emotional, it's logical. is providing wonderful ecological services in terms of air, fresh air, water, well-being downstream in other parts of the country. It also regulating things, soil conservation and all kind of floods control. It is ensuring gene pool for future generations in terms of flora and fauna, because many birds, they are coming to Himachal Pradesh to breed in summer and then they are going back to their respective places. So it is ensuring a gene pool to the future generation. We are already connected carbon state. We're doing a lot of, things to reduce the carbon. So a lot of bio-values, fauna diversity here, but Himachal has its own limitations. They need money to knowledge sharing also. So we have to share the knowledge to do, extend our tentacles for conservation and protection of these species, not only within the state of the country, but across the borders as well. So thank you, friends, from my side. And thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, sir. That was indeed a wonderful talk for us, and more than a wonderful talk. I mean, I would say we also you have also reminded us our responsibility towards the basic bird watching or nature watch, which we do. Mm. What responsibility we should undertake. So now we have actually opened the chat for everyone to ask their questions. So please, you could ask your questions, and you can go ahead.
Sure, please.
So, sir, I have the first question here from S. Raghupati Garu. His question is, what is the best time to visit Pong Valley to see maximum number of species?
Raghupati, good evening. You see, if you want to see, general species, ducks and geese and waders, I will divide in three, span of time. One is before 20th of December. Why I'm saying you will see less number of species, but visibility is more because there's no haze. So before 20th and from 20th and last of Jan, the maximum number of ducks and geese are there. You can see them, but the visibility will be less. But if you really want to see some rare species, then I think Feb, March, April is the best time, because species from other areas, coast and central India, they will also join in Pong before going to their breeding areas, breeding points. They will stay in Pong for some time. And that is the best time, I think, you can come. Or if you are interested, then you can join us in annual estimation count in the last week of Jan. And then later on, you can do birding also. Yeah.
Thank you. And also he asked, best way to reach Pong Valley from Raghupati Garu.
So there are different ways. If by train, you can come to Pathankot. Then from Pathankot is 1.5 hour journey from Pathankot. Or there's a Dharamshala airport also. So just 1 hour journey from that airport. You can come from Chandigarh also, Delhi, Chandigarh, and then by taxi also.
Yes. Yeah, Raghupati Garu, I hope you got your answer, sir. The next question, any book regarding the importance of birds for human beings by Mr. Prashant Chauhan?
For human beings?
Yeah.
Interesting. It's interesting. I will get you later on, I think, to see and search for it.
So we will let you know, Prashant. I mean, please drop in your email address and we will definitely drop in some book ideas for you.
Vikant?
Yes, sir.
I think there's one book, Ashish will bear me out on that.
Yes.
It's a book by a gentleman from the UK called Mark Cocker. And the book is titled Birds and People.
Okay. So,
it's available on Amazon.
Yes.
So Mark Cocker.
Okay.
C-O-C-K-E-R. Mark.
C-K-E-R. Okay.
C-O-C-K-E-R. Birds and People, I think it's called.
Birds and People. So there, Mr. Prashant, you have your book name. So, yeah. And I'm just waiting for other questions. So, sir, I have a particular question regarding a few species. I would like to, because I know that you have worked in GHNP area, especially towards the conservation of Western Tragopan. So we would like to know your efforts in that area, or how it was conserved and the need for conserving that species especially.
Okay, so I got an opportunity and I was posted in the year 2011 in Great Himalayan National Park. So there, what we could do during last month, last week or fortnight of March, we divided the entire GHNP into different grids, looking at its habitat. So I put different teams in those grids, and we used to go midnight there and stay there. And at around four or so, we will reach at the grids and start recording the calls. So we recorded the calls of different grids, and then we came to know the encounter rate of calls in those grids. So that is one indication that where is the probability more to get the Western Tragopan in GHNP. So that's what we did there. As far as conservation is concerned, and you know, this Western Tragopan is very habitat specialist. It needs different set of climatic condition and stay there only. So we try to understand those conditions, and people now working there, they are trying to do those interventions, management intervention. Luckily, very few people are going to those areas. I still remember that Mike Pandya and his team, he got a kind of MOU with state government to videograph and photograph Western Tragopan in Great Himalayan National Park. So his cameraman used to, you know, say no after a few days, then they will come back, and then they will But I was deputed with them. Then in 7 days or so, we got videograph and first clip, to my knowledge, of
that is correct.
So we got that video clip also and photograph also. But that we did based on that encounter rate we did earlier. So if you really want to see Western Tragopan, I think those indications you have to keep in mind before going to Great Himalaya. Because okay, the terrain is so difficult, if you go to wrong place, the chances will be less.
Yes. Yes. So, sir, I mean, thank you, sir. Thank you for your answer. And there are many people who have been appreciating your talk. Thanks so much. And also by Ms. Janaki Rao, I mean, Asif and
Srinivas.
Thanks a lot. And Ms. Janaki Rao, who is also a DFO Social Forestry.
Oh.
She's from Andhra Pradesh Social Forestry. Oh,
great.
So, yeah. So, sir, we have our next question, which is, what is the best time to visit GHNP? Prashant has answered April and May. I hope that is correct.
He's from problem with the May and April and May is, they say, that is also good time because the birds are calling that time. You can locate them easily. After that, because the males are silent, you can't you can't hear the call. So difficult to locate the bird. Well, only thing I will suggest is that you stay maybe 2 kilometers before those locations overnight in a tent or in a hide. And then midnight or so, 3 o'clock in the morning, you go alone or with one or two person, don't talk, move very slowly, because even with the vibration in the throw the rocks, I think the bird will understand that there's something, and then they will slowly disappear from the side. So those things you have to keep in mind. So that is the best, I think, that is one of the best time, April. May will be a little difficult because snow will melt and then you have to go a little further and further up. So April will be the best time, I think.
Right. So the next one is by Mr. JVD Murthy. The question is, what is the secret of the success behind the increasing vulture population in Himachal Pradesh?
Small interventions. I will not give any judgment, but the small intervention, number one, we protected the habitat from fire because they were breeding on Pinus roxburghii. Those are fire-prone species. So we protected all the nesting sites, number one, by involving the communities. Number two, that was a big task that those forest corporation in Himachal Pradesh, they were extracting resin from Pinus trees. They were also felling these dried trees and selling them for money. So we have to stop the felling in those 45 plus sites in district Kangra. So it was a big task, but anyhow, we could convince government and forest corporation also, and now it is stopped. Number three is we are doing undercover survey also with the NSAIDs and other drugs. So what is the availability in Himachal? Luckily, the availability is less. People are not totally dependent on Baclofen. It is not available. No human version is there. So that we are doing regularly. And the next point is that traditionally people used to de-skin in Himachal Pradesh. So de-skinning now have been reduced. People are not taking this profession. So we identified those people who were doing traditionally, those old people. And we got all the address and contact number. And now we are involving them and they are de-skinning the animals, carcass. And we are putting in those vulture feeding station. We also have vulture feeding station. It's not basically to ensure the feed to the vultures, but the idea is different to know their ecological behavior, the feeding behaviors and all kind of things. So these small interventions we did, I think probably these may be the reason that vulture population is bouncing back. Fire is at the top, I will say, because fire will destroying all these nests and they were not breeding in those sites also.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. Thank you, sir. Thank you for that. And next question is by Sheikh Hussain.
Yeah.
My question is about vultures. How safe is the whole zone after banning of NSAIDs in Himachal? And mm-hmm. have been releasing them any other crisis, not only for vultures, but any other birds? What are the departmental efforts other than funding is being carried out?
So, first part is Hussainji, is your safe zone in Himachal?
Yes.
It's not legally declared. Like there's a safe zone that's covering up to Unna district. But the vultures are breeding in that area, district Kangra, is not part of safe zone, notified safe zone. I don't know. That may not be fitting in their parameters, 100 kilometer radius or so. So anyhow, historically, if we see use of teclofenic in Himalayas, I think people, they were using their local medicine to treat animals. So they hardly depend upon medicine to cure their animals. So use of teclofenic and other NSAIDs, that was less comparatively in Himachal as compared to other states. So that one region. And second question, part of the question was? Sorry, I forgot.
Yeah, the second part, are there any other birds for which these efforts are being taken? Departmental efforts other than funding?
We have this breeding program for Western Tragopan in Srahan. We also have a breeding program for Cheat pheasant. We also have small pheasantry for Monal at Manali also. So these are the species which are being bred and then they will be released. As far as chid pheasant is concerned, we already have released them under soft release.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. I think the next question is from Shravan Kumar. His question is, can you please share a little more about HP carbon negative, in Himachal Pradesh, carbon negative, and are there any steps taken by the government through reforms?
He's from Delhi.
No, he is actually from Hyderabad, sir. But
okay. Sarvanji, I am trying to highlight the contribution of Himachal Pradesh to other states. So Himachal, we have 66% of the forest area under forest, and we have good number of trees, and we are free from hardly any industry in Himachal. So hardly any industry, pollution, comparatively pollution free state. And lot of forest cover. So that is what I'm saying. And population is less. We have around 70 lakh people in Himachal. So that is one reason that we are kind of carbon neutral state. Yeah.
So next question is by Ms. Bharti.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, after the Gaja cyclone during the past 2 years, the bird presence at Point Calimar is very low or almost nil.
Mm-hmm.
So was this reflected in Himachal as well?
Not exactly. Total population, I will not say there is a change. The unfortunate part is when we are talking about population in wild conditions, there are many variants. and we have no coordination, we have no sharing of things with one another. I will talk one species only, bar-headed geese. Forget about other species. If you talk bar-headed geese, we have more than 50,000 birds in Himachal Pradesh. Mm-hmm. But if I will say that their number is going up, no, we can't say, because we don't have population of bar-headed geese from the sonic states, number one. Number two, even if we have the population data, we collected data in the end of Jan. Other people are probably collecting mid-Jan or somewhere, some other time. So that will of no use when we are talking the population of species landscape level. So it is another, I will say, gap that at least we have to start coordinating with the surrounding states, that the date of the census should not vary much, and we have to share the data with one another of different species. Unless we have that sharing of data, we cannot say the population going up and down. But as far as Himachal is concerned, population is just fluctuating. I will not say it's going down, it's just fluctuating. No.
Okay.
Difficult to say at this
point. Okay. Thank you, sir. And the next question is by Mr. Subramanian Shankar. He asks, is there a possibility of getting certified in bird ringing during the annual estimation at Kanda?
Yes. But for that, you have to apply to Chief Wildlife Board on Himachal Pradesh. You apply during Jan, early Jan, and then the application will be processed, and those will be selected, and they can join in ringing exercise also. They can join in annual bird count also. So after that, we will issue the certificate. Whosoever will be there, the responsible person, he will issue the certificate.
Right. Thank you, Sushant. And next question is by Ms. Kajal Das Gupta. It was wonderful to listen to someone like you who knows about birds of Himachal Pradesh the best. Did you notice any significant change in the habitat of Pong Dam area over the years? So this is a two-part question. The first part is, did you notice any significant change in the habitat of Pong Dam area over the years?
Mm-hmm.
And has it affected any migratory species besides the large flock of bar-headed geese, mm-hmm, and others who are regularly visiting Pong Dam?
I will say yes at micro level. Yes, I will say yes. If you see a relative family, rails, crakes and bitterns, we have a very unique, a very small point where this reeds and stagnant water is there. So those are the private plants, and which has been converted now into fish ponds and all. So those snipes and these ducks, rails, crakes, they are redistributed, I will say. They are not gone to other areas. They are redistributed. We also did small interventions. We are trying to do species-specific interventions in Pong Lake, like Saras crane. We created ponds. They started breeding now. Historically, they were there, but their population has decreased over the years. Now they are coming up. They have started breeding now. We also did the small intervention in open areas, drawdown areas. But we spread the seeds of those Cassia tora and local beets. So those beets, when their areas getting exposed, water is receding. So those beets, they are providing a partial hides to lot of these bagtails, beetles, larks species. So earlier they were not coming probably, or if they were coming, they were staying 1 or 2 days. But now their stay in Pong has been, is longer now. It's they are staying for longer time period now. So likewise, we did some intervention for roosting of the species, girl centers, also for vultures, feeding point and roosting places. And we are also trying to create different set of habitats. For example, Nugrotta suriya, we were already having deep waters, shallow banks. We have agriculture lands now, different set of agriculture lands now. We have scrubs in the higher reaches. And we have also created a small patch or two patches of forest also, so that birds from Himalayas, leapfrog migration there, will stay there for some time. Since we have a ringing, permanent ringing station, so we need a different set of habitat there to arrest the migration. And birds stay there, their number will increase and diversity will increase. So we are addressing those habitats. but looking the requirement in open ecology, ecosystem, because unnecessarily we don't want to create habitats also, because there's also may not be good also for the species. But small interventions we are trying to do. As far as the habitat, it will be incomplete if we will not talk about water quality. So that is deteriorating over the years. And we have, it's a big challenge, you know, the entire watershed, the habitation, they are using a lot of chemicals, pesticides, you know, and those urea and all kind of things. So habitat, yes, it is deteriorating, but the visible signs are less there. So it will take longer time. On this skimmer has stopped breeding in Pong Lake over last 3-4 years. There are a few indications, but difficult to say unless we have a set of, you know, recorded parameters in hand.
Mr. Dasgupta, I hope you've got your answer, sir. So, just relating to this question, sir, are there any indicator species for Pong Dam which give you an indication? As you said, skimmers are one indication where they're not breeding now in Pong Dam. So are there any other indicator species which are there?
Brahmini shelduck, ruddy shelduck, its population more or less is stagnant over the years because more on the right bank where the freshwater streams are joining. So their number is good enough to tell that, okay, right now the health is not so bad. Thankfully, we have Dholadhar ranges, and the Dholadhar ranges every year they are providing fresh water, and the quality is somehow it is maintained right now. So they are indicative species are there.
Okay.
Not much variation. Yeah.
Right. So thank you so much for answering that. And Miss, Bhargavi Subbaya asks a question. Any ground nesting birds in HP in Himachal Pradesh?
Yes, many. Around 45 species I have recorded in Pong Lake. They are breeding like little tern, gullible tern, river tern, thickneys, Indian and that great thickney, little plovers, and this little cormorant and herons, and all kind of things, egrets, they are breeding there. And in Karansar Island, they are breeding in thousands. Even you can't walk, you can't step in. There are eggs everywhere. So they are breeding on grounds.
Wow. Thank you. I hope you got your answer there. Next is, sir, again, I'm receiving a lot of thanks for the talk, and everyone is appreciating so much for the valuable talk and the presentation.
Thank you, sir,
again. And Binduji has actually asked, Bindu Dadwalji, she asked, please let me know how to get the books, Birds of Himachal Pradesh, Volume 1 and Volume 2. I think it will help even our other listeners.
Okay, so you can get it online also. And they are available on Amazon also. Or you can drop me a message on my telephone number. So I can arrange them. There is no problem.
Yes. Yeah. And just quickly going through the other questions. What was felt in Dharamshala area with regard to rise or fall in number of bird species during recent lockdown? What change was felt in Dharamshala area with regard to increase or decreasing in the number of bird species because of the lockdowns?
You know, it will not be wise if I would say up and down, because sample size is so small and difficult to say. But yes, few species which are dependent on humans, or rather I would say garbage, crows and even sparrows and mynas, and probably visitors, they are not coming to Dharamshala now. So they are not getting enough food to eat and feed. So there might be negative impact on these species, which are dependent on humans and habitations now. But the rest of the species, I think they are enjoying like anything, because there is no movement of humans inside. They have cleaner environment and conditions, undisturbed conditions. So it's very good for other species to grow, because one main species is controlled, that is humans are controlled now. But there can be a negative impact on species which are human dependent. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then, sir. I'm receiving a lot of appreciation for the talk. Thank you again. And I would actually, in the chat, I've done with the question. Anyone wishes to ask any questions, can you please raise your hand? Or would you like to type in, or you can raise your hand and be glad to take, I think, a few more questions. Yeah. So, one question. I always wanted to understand what is so special in Pong League that it attracts. I've heard the presentation, but is there something else which is so special? Because the number of birds or the variety of species which we see there is much different. Lesser white-fronted and greater white-fronted goose every year. Almost last 3 years, we've been sighting that continuously. Yeah. So what could be the reason for those species to visit this area?
No, although Pong is a artificial wetland, it's not a natural wetland, but looking at the quality of the water, I salute Dholadhar ranges that every year we are getting fresh water. There's no industry. So I would say there's enough feed for these ducks along the shoreline. There's aquatic invertebrates and floating in summers, vegetation is there. And photopaired during winter, enough photopaired during winter also. So those are the few factors. And location of Pong, because location of Pong is under the those migratory routes across the borders. And look, it's quite close to the breeding grounds also in Central Asia and Tibet and all. So these are the few conditions, few regions. Besides, Pong provide opportunity to different genera of species. Those set of different habitat sets and subsets, they ensure enough to feed, roost, and hide. So those are the, I think, wonderful contribution for species, not only for transitory points, but to yes, stay during winter and so on. Okay.
So what about the poaching in that area? Is it rampant or is it controlled? Is there any kind of poaching in that?
It was rampant earlier, but now with the involvement of communities, because we have society there. Although there is a resentment everywhere, there is a resentment, but that agriculture is stopped now, cropping is stopped. People are now cooperating with the department, and there is a less poaching now. People don't poach in openly with gun and all. But honestly, I will not say that 100% it is controlled. That will not be true answer, I think. But nobody is poaching in the front, in the open now.
Okay. Yes. That's actually good. So Rajshekar has a question. So yeah, Rajshekar, please go.
Well, sir, your presentation is excellent. And I would like to congratulate you on this front.
Thanks.
And so my quick question is, earlier I had experience of involving in the year of Tehri Dam and Arki Hills. Yes. So my questions are related to why are the cement plants just given permissions in no-go areas like in Dharmashala or in Kangra areas or in the apple orchards been given permission, and there is also YS Parmar University in Himachal Pradesh, which has a locust handy. So are there any promoting bird-friendly species and restricting the range level of species at elevation only plantation can be taken care of?
See, if I could get your answer properly, I think it's not the plantation. We should forget plantation for the time being. When we are talking any non-human species, so we have to respect that habitat. So, the mudflats, rocks, stones, barren lands, scrublands, grasses, they have their own importance. Because nature has created them. There's an evolution process behind it. They have created it, but we are converting them into tree lands now. So nature will not accept it, because whatever we are surviving, whatever we are eating now, I have seen this argument also that we plant trees, animals will come themselves. No, it's not true. If we plant trees, how will we get seeds? It's pollination. The pollination is done by birds and insects. So we have to give equal importance to non-human species, birds and other animals. that they are doing pollination, and by virtue of pollination, we are getting seeds, and that's why trees are growing. That's why other plants are growing. So it's a vice versa. So planting trees means we are creating homogeneous ecosystem, which will nature will never accept it, never, and it will destroy different habitat layerings for other species, which are habitat specialist species. I will give you one example. Like if you go to any Himalaya, any mountain or hill, there are grass patches in between. There's trees all around, grass patches. So people will go and plant trees there. They will plant, Goral will disappear. They will plant finches and other species, they will disappear. There's no need to hunt any species. So that is a organized crime we are doing. I don't know, knowingly or unknowingly, but we have to have an informed decision before doing something. So it's the habitat which is very important, not the plantation.
Yes, sir.
And Rajshekhar, I hope you got your hands up. One more question on the chat, sir, for you. I'm not sure what the name is, but the question is, what progress the Migratory Birds Research Center has made since its inception in Pong? Any specific highlights?
See, we are doing ringing and collaring since 2006-07 with BNHS, and later on with scientists from Games and Wildlife Trust of London and other organizations. But that is not organized. Whenever government is giving funds, they are doing it and coming, and that is not systematic. Now we have permanent ringing station. So I think, thankfully, Honorable Chief Minister of Himachal Pradesh has made it, it's a policy matter now. It's a part of the announcement that, yes, there will be a permanent ringing station. So hopefully we will get funds now. But I request to everyone that we have wonderful resources, we have wonderful diversity of birds, and it's going to play a big role. So other part of the country and even international organizations, they should come forward to fund, because we need funding. We have the manpower, we have the center, we have other facility, we have bird diversity, but funds we need. We have to collaborate with one another. Yes. We just started from the ringing station.
Okay. There's one more person who's actually asking for a question. One second, sir. I'm just unmuted. And this would be, yeah.
Yeah. Hi, Devinder.
Hello, sir. Good evening.
Yeah. It was my question actually on Migratory Bird Research Center. Congratulations, first of all. And great to see you on this platform.
Thank you.
I would like to tell everybody that I've seen this man's growth since he started all those works in vulture conservation in Kangra. I was with him. And fortunately, at every place, I call him my guru. Oh. He gave me instinct to, recognize the birds and knowledge till now, it is due to this person only. Thanks.
Your greatness.
And congratulations.
Your greatness. Sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's lovely, sir. Thank you for joining us. And actually, I would say, in reintroducing a great person to us. Thank you. So, yes, Rajshekhar. One more. Yeah, Rajshekhar, go.
Dadwal, sir, any measures to rediscover Himal, enigmatic Himalayan quail?
Yes, number of feet has to be increased in Himalayas. Yes. Number of feet. More people required to scan the area.
Yes, sir.
Especially breeding time, if possible, especially breeding time. Courtship time, I would say, because that time birds are active and calling also. So we target the courtship time, and then more people are there, then we can scan the area. That's the only way. Or we can use technology these days, camera traps and all. So if we come to close to the potential habitat in the areas, so in those potential habitat, we can put camera traps, and then we'll get some wonderful results. And why not? Why not? We'll say that, yes, we will get it someday.
Yes, sir.
I hope we do someday. Thanks, Rajshekhar, for bringing that up, because it's a very important species which has been extinct for a long time now, or rather presumably extinct. So I think no further questions, sir, and I really thank you very much, sir, on behalf of Deccan Birders and all the participants as well. And thank you.
Thanks. Thanks a lot. Thanks, yeah, everyone.
Thank you. And I thank all the participants as well for joining us and giving us your inputs and, you know, for being patient through the talk. Amazing. It was an amazing experience.
Absolutely. Dadwalji, thank you so much. Murthy here. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you, sir, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Not at all. Maza aa gaya.
Thanks a lot.
What is now remaining is to double that maza by coming to Himachal.
Sure. Oh, most yeah. Welcome. Anytime you can come.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
So thanks, everyone. Please, you can search for all our prior webinars and also this webinar on YouTube on our Deccan Birders channel. So this would be uploaded by tomorrow, so you all can view it again. And probably again, you can share it with your friends and you can join our channel. Ask them to join the channel as well. So thanks, everyone. Thank you for being patient and thank you so much for joining us for yet another interesting Deccan Birders webinar session. Thank you.
We have two more coming up next weekend. Sikand, you can make the announcement.
Yes, sir. One moment, please. I'm just bringing up the schedule. Yeah, just to be very clear. Yes, so we are coming up. We have two more coming up next weekend. One is on Saturday. That would be by Mr. Chris Bowden on Vultures of South India. And we have one on Sunday as well by Dr. A.J.T. Johnson on how to be a responsible naturalist.
Yeah, Chris Bowden, I think, is a name known to everyone.
Yes.
He's going to talk about where have the vultures of South India gone.
Exactly.
And Dr. A.J.T. Johnson is from the Wildlife Institute of India, Dehradun, the former dean there. And he's very well known in wildlife circles. Very, very well known. So please do join us next weekend, Saturday and Sunday, for these two webinars. Thank you all.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Thanks for joining. Thank you, JVC. Thank you, Dadwal sir, again. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, Srikant. Thanks.
Bye, sir. Thank you.